كتاب الله كتاب الله
كتاب الله
كتاب الله
كتاب الله
We're talking about the economic system of Islam. Remember that we were talking about the restrictions in Sharia. So I was talking that there are two types of restrictions. One are the moral restrictions, and about morality we already know that the moral law is that you shouldn't lie, you shouldn't cheat, you shouldn't betray the promise. These are all the moral teachings. So morally, you don't have to learn from a chef that whether you should cheat your customer or not. Morally, from inside, you know that you should not cheat your customer, you should not lie to your customer, you should not mix the good stuff with the bad stuff while selling. You should not defraud, you should not reduce the quantity, you should not reduce the length of your product that you are selling. All this is called moral. Then there are the restrictions of Sharia. The restriction of Sharia means only those restrictions which you can find out from the Sharia that they are haram. Okay, we are talking about the restrictions. About the restrictions of Sharia, the most important and most widely questioned and widely resisted restriction of Islam is the prohibition of riba. Restriction on riba, interest. Riba. The way Quran bans this is unprecedented. No other restriction has been imposed the way restriction on riba has been imposed. Quran says if you don't give up this, then get ready to fight against Allah and His Messenger. You know, some who ask me that they want to indulge in riba and they are not having any way out and they try to get permission from me. You know, the banks devalue the money. Who gains? A rich man who is able to borrow from banks. He makes assets and then devalues the money. And banks are the major tool in this process of inflation. Banks make the poor even more poor. And they make the rich even more rich. This is the worst form of human exploitation. The worst form of human exploitation. And if you have an understanding of the banking system, if you have the understanding of the insurance system, only then you can appreciate the saying of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran that if you don't give up riba, get ready to fight against Allah and His Messenger. What is riba? How it differs from a good loan and business proposition? Basically, when someone is doing a business of his own,
with his own money. There's no problem at all. The problem arises when one man is contributing money and the other is working on it. Now, what should be the division of the profit? How should the profit be divided? Or if there is a loss, who should bear the loss? Simple equation says that you equally share both the capital and the labor should contribute. One is contributing his labor and time, and the other is contributing the capital, the money. And at the end of the day, they should divide whatever is the outcome. If they lose, they should equally face the loss. And if they gain, they should equally divide the gain. But the question is, if there is a gain, yes, you can divide and both will get the benefit. But if there is a loss, someone who is contributing money, that was his surplus money. While for the one who was working, that was his bread and butter. If he doesn't get at the end of the year, that means whatever he was giving to his children during the year, that will become a loan against him. And then next year again the same thing happens. He will be under more debt. So, you know, this is a normal procedure. But now, the capitalist approach and the Islamic approach are absolutely opposite to each other. The capitalist approach is, if you gain, both the capital and the labor should share the gain, profit. But if you lose, the worker should lose, the capital should not lose. You know, in simple it is said, if you borrow a money from someone for your business and you lose, you will not only pay back the money at any cost, but in addition you will pay, you can name it a profit, you have to pay him the profit too, which you have already decided. This is riba. Islamic approach is opposite to that. Islamic approach is, whenever there is a loss, loss should be borne by the capital and not by the labor. Not only that, the capital should recompense the labor even if there is a loss. Even if there is a loss, the capital should recompensate the labor. You know the concept of wages. You know, the ideal proposition is, initially there should be a wage of the labor, but when you get profit, then a share of the profit should also be given to the labor. That is the ideal condition. Or take the other way around, the example of a loan. Suppose you borrow some amount from someone. The Islamic loan is that you borrow the money, make a commitment that you will pay this in such and such month, such and such date. Try to pay it. If you cannot pay, then the other person should give you relaxation. And if you are unable to pay, he should waive it off. This is the ideal loan. Ideal loan. And this is called Hasana. You know, very often you read in the Quran, Qarz Hasana. Mostly in the Quran, this Qarz Hasana is used for giving to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah reassures that you give Allah a loan, that means you make and you give loan to Allah. Spend in His cause. spend where He wants you to spend, Allah Almighty will return you with addition on the day of judgment. So that is another thing. But between the human beings, the good loan called asna is that if you give someone, some brother, a loan and he is not able to pay on time, give him time. And if he can pay, cannot pay at all, give it off. So this is the ideal condition. You know, one brother asked my teacher, Dr. Sar Ahmed, that I want to have an agency of cars. You know, I want to open a car showroom and I don't have that much amount. Can I borrow from the bank? He gave a beautiful answer. Sir, is it necessary for you to open a car showroom, open a motorcycle showroom? You know, all the problem lies here. I have certain amount with me, but I want to do business 10 times to that amount. And so I go to the bank. So this approach is right. What you have, go with this amount in the business. Pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives barakah in it and you gain more and then you develop your business. This is the right way. Another important thing is that different business propositions. For example, one is selling and buying proposition. Other is ijara, giving something on rent. This is another proposition. From Islamic point of view, you are not supposed to mix the two. Whenever you make a deal, it should be either a deal of ijara or a deal of sale or purchase. Mostly what the banks do, they call so-called Islamic banking. What they do is they say, oh, it's ijara. And they get fatwa from the sheikh. Ijara is allowed? Yes, it is allowed. But if you read the contract is that we are giving you the car. For 2 years it will be on ijara, and then after 2 years you will have to purchase it. This is wrong. If it is ijara, after 2 years you can give it back. After 2 months you say, okay, I don't need it anymore, give it back. There should be no extra restrictions. When you mix two things, this will also be not allowed. Similarly, in case of land also, Rasulullah ﷺ has put certain restrictions. Then there are restrictions on the delayed payment. Rasulullah ﷺ stopped from bilateral delayed payment. And all these things actually, they raise the prices. Bilateral delayed payment means I make a business proposition, that is a sale and purchase deal, and I say, okay, I purchase this for 1 million shillings, but I don't have this at present with me. So I'll only pay you 100,000. And the other party will say, I don't have that object to deliver it to you. So I'll gradually deliver you. Know what these two persons are doing? The one who can do a cash payment, he can purchase it for 900,000. Now this man, he has offered him 1 million, and by this way the price has been raised to 100,000. You know, the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are prophetic sayings. Apparently when you read them once, you will see, oh, it's a restriction just for nothing. But when you go deep, you will find, yes, they are all to help the poor people and the general masses. Any system which supports the general masses is the best system. And any system which takes care of certain classes of the society is always an exploitive system. You know, in the beginning, I was telling you that there are two systems in Islam. One is spiritual system and the other is the legal system. Why I was telling you that, I must make it clear, that in telling the economic system of Islam, certain scholars, they try to prove with reference to the spiritual system that Islam is like communism. While the others, they on the basis of the law of inheritance and zakat and this, they try to prove that Islam is a capitalist system. No, Islam is neither capitalism nor communism. At the legal level, yes, it allows to have private ownership. But overall concept that it in the end belongs to Allah, Allah has the right to put some restrictions even on your so-called property. If you understand this point, then inshallah you can move both of them parallel to each other, and then you can say this is moral teaching, this is spiritual teaching, and this is the legal structure of the economic system of Islam. So, I don't want to go into the detail, neither I have time nor I find myself up to that mark that I can discuss these things in detail. But if you have basic concept very clear, and then you go to the shuyukh, inshallah, they can guide you the legal aspects of Islam. Keep that in mind, that overall moral and spiritual approach should be in your mind, that this does not belong to me.